Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika an adilla aw udalla aw azilla aw uzalla aw azlima aw uzlama aw ajhala aw yujhala alayya. Nawayna at-ta'alluma wa-ta'aleem wa-tadhakkara wa-tadhkir wa-nafa wa-intifa' wa-ifadata wa-istifada. We intend to learn and to teach and to remember and to remind and to provide benefit and to benefit and to be helpful and to gain. وَالْحَثُّ عَلَى التَّمَسُّكِ بِكِتَابِ اللَّهِ وَسُنَّةِ رَسُولِهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ and to encourage adherence to the Book of Allah and the way of His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَالدُّعَاءَ إِلَى الْهُدَى وَالدِّلَالَةَ عَلَى الْخَيْرِ and to supplicate for right guidance and to show the way to good. ابْتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ اللَّهِ وَمَرْضَاتِهِ وَقُرْبِهِ وَثَوَابِهِ seeking the countenance of Allah and His contentment, nearness and reward, subhanahu wa ta'ala, transcendent and ascendant. So we're continuing with chapter 13. كَثْرَةُ طُرُقِ الْخَيْرِ. How many ways there is in Islam to leave the world a little bit better than how it was when you found it. MashaAllah. I believe that we left off with hadith number 9 in chapter 13. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, Al-Imanu bid'un wa sab'una shu'ba. Faith is 70 or so branches. فَأَفْضَلُهَا قَوْلُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. The highest is your saying there is none worthy of the attachment of our hearts to it except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ مِنْ قَلْبَيْنِ بِجَوْفِهِ. That's what لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ means. Allah has not made for a man two hearts in his breast, only one. And it's for him, right? Subhanallah. That's the meaning of La ilaha illallah. Wa ajnaha imatatul adha an at-tariq, and the lowest of those branches, the closest of those branches, is to remove something harmful from the path. And we've talked about this hadith many times. And then he says, wal haya'u shu'batun min al-iman, and modesty is a branch of faith. Subhanallah. Modesty, shyness. Haya is very important for many reasons. We understand modesty, inshallah, at least in theory, we understand modesty, right? Haya is important practically because if people don't have a little bit of shyness, well, then they'll just take advantage of others. In the Arab world, they say if somebody is out there taking advantage of others, throwing people under the bus, doing unethical things, the Syrians will say, "Ma bistahi," right? He's not shy, right? He's not shy. A little bit of shyness is important so that people understand their limits. They say, "Ni'ma rajul man 'arafa haddahu wa waqafa 'indah." The best man is the one who knows his limits and stops there, doesn't go further. Doesn't get busy beyond his pay grade, right? Not working beyond his qualifications or her qualifications. Subhanallah. And that's what makes the world function properly, smoothly. Right? When we all do what we're supposed to be doing, when we all carry our weight, or when we all carry the weight we're supposed to be carrying, not carrying the weight, not letting the ball, not letting the ball drop and not carrying the weight we're not supposed to be carrying. Subhanallah. The next hadith, number 10. Al-Ashir. Anna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Baynama rajulun yamshi bi tariqin ishtadda alayhi al-atash, fawajada bi'ran, fanazala fiha, fasharab. There was a man, and this is a story from the nations that went before us, right, from the tribes of Bani Israel. There was a man who was walking along the road and he became very thirsty and he found a well. And so he went down into the well and drank. ثم خرج فإذا كلب يلهث يأكل الثرى من العطش. When he came back up, he found, in this well-known hadith, a dog that was panting and licking the dirt itself, trying to get some of the drops of water that might be left over from the well. And the man said to himself, لقد بلغ هذا الكلب من العطش مثل الذي كان قد بلغ مني. This dog has reached a point of thirst, the same point I had reached of thirst. فنزل البئر. So he went back down into the well, and he filled up his shoe with water, and he held it in his mouth, and he climbed back out of the well, and he gave the dog to drink. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appreciated this effort and forgave all of his sins. Subhanallah. Empathy. Subhanallah. This man is rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for having empathy for a dog. What then about showing empathy for a child of Adam? Subhanallah. And they said, when the messenger told this story, Ya Rasulullah, inna lana fil baha'imi ajra. We get a reward for treating animals well. Subhanallah. Faqala, but the wahi is happening right then and there. They're learning right then and there. The reason why many of us, if not for the fitra, that obviously this is a sentient being, we should treat it well. Huh? Many of us, we, in retrospect, we know all of these things. But there are societies where nobody was on hand to teach people these things. So they say, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Islam has returned the way it began, a stranger. So you can go to places in the Muslim world and you can see people abusing animals in the most terrible fashion, as if they don't subscribe or follow a prophet that taught them differently. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad. But that's one of the signs that Islam is now strange once more amongst its people. Ibrahim alayhi salat wa salam was the one who named us Muslims. And he and Ismail spent their time in Mecca. But Islam became a stranger once more in Mecca. And it's become a stranger amongst our people too. So he said, fi kulli kabadin rutbatin ajrun. In every moist liver, literally, every living thing, it's just a euphemism for living thing. In every living thing, there's a reward. There's another narration that comes along this, with this. بينما كلب يطيف. Or is it the next one? Hold on. No. He says, بينما كلب يطيف بركية قد كان يقتله العطش إذ رأته بغي. In another narration of the same story, there is a dog, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the one speaking. A dog is about to die of thirst, and a prostitute saw the dog. Min baghaya bani Israel, from the prostitutes of the people of Israel. فنزعت موقها فاستقت له به. So she sent down, she lowered down, I believe it will be her shoe. Give me a moment here, let's just be sure. Now, the same thing. So she lowered down her shoe and she filled it with water. And she brought it back up and she gave the dog to drink. Just like the story of the man. فَسَقَتْهُ فَغُفِرَ لَهَا بِهِ. And so she was forgiven. Right? For giving that dog to drink. Subhanallah. We'll look first at the dog. We think of dogs as najis. Right? The dog is najis. If the dog licks something, you have to wash it, you know, so many times, and once, you know, with dirt, and all of this, just to take care of that. Najasa al-ghaliza, mughallaba. طيب. But just because the dog is najis in fiqh, doesn't mean that we can't or shouldn't be careful, that we shouldn't show empathy for the dog, that we shouldn't feel for the dog, or dogs in general, or even pigs, or any type of animal. They don't need to be punished for their condition. They don't need to be punished for their condition. This is part of our ta'abbud of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That when certain things contact certain things, we're to respond in this way. It's not an abuse or a curse on the actual animal itself, or the source of that najasa. Subhanallah. And it also speaks to the importance of a soul. The importance of a soul. But what about the prostitute from Bani Israel? And it's true, yes, we don't say that that animals have souls. They don't have rational souls. They don't have souls like a human soul. But one position amongst our theologians is that there is such a thing as an animal soul and even a vegetable soul, right? Anything that has the capacity for growth has a type of soul. This is one theory. And then growth plus movement is another type of soul. And then above that, growth plus movement plus intellect, right, becomes a superior level of soul. No. But we can show compassion for living things. And what about the prostitute? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us in this well-known hadith that out of appreciation for her effort to give the dog to drink, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all of her sins because she could feel for another. Nowhere does it say that she stopped being a prostitute. It doesn't say that. It just says Allah forgave her. Subhanallah. Our job on the face of the earth is not to judge other people. Our job on the face of the earth is to have compassion for people. Not to look down on anyone. That's not what we're here for. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the estimations and values of souls. That's not our business. Our business is to make right choices. Subhanallah. So, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who ultimately makes all of the decisions about who's forgiven and who's not, whose deeds are accepted and whose are not, we are responsible for the fiqh. Right? Allahumma saddidna wa karribna. Make us more precise in our fiqh. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ultimate judge. We don't have any business about who goes to Jannah and who goes to opposite destinations. Allah put us in the Jannah. Everybody all around us and everybody that we encounter. Protect us from opposite destinations. That's not our business, that's Allah's business. Allah makes the judgments in the end. We don't say who's going where. But what we know is that there are certain actions that Allah has advised us to avoid. And certain actions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has encouraged us to engage with. That's our business. Because those things that Allah has said He's pleased with, that's where you expect to find Jannah. And those things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that He's displeased with, that's where you expect to find punishment, wal-'iyadu billah, but the ultimate decision returns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if out of appreciation for helping the life even of even an animal that's considered najis, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can forgive the sins of a woman who, from the previous generation doesn't even know Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or have the love of the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam in her heart, then what might Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do for people whose hearts are overflowing with the love of his beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah. We don't know the secrets of the hearts. Ashaqaqta an qalbihi? Did you break open his heart to see what was inside? He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. People have secrets between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we don't know. We don't know. I once was told, a man once confided in me a story that, and this is in the Muslim world, he said that he was with a prostitute, Allah forgive him, Allah forgive us, he was with a prostitute, and at the moment he was about to consummate the act, I suppose they must have been having a pleasant conversation or something like this, and he came to know that she was from the family of the Prophet ﷺ. And he said, I couldn't go through with it, right? And I stood up and I left. Subhanallah. We don't know the secrets and the situations where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يَحِنُّ عَلَى, right, is gentle and relents toward a person. And it's not for us to judge, it's for us to hope for ourselves. And if we have a little bit of hope left over, invest some hope in others too. The next hadith, number 11. That the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, لَقَدْ رَأَيْتُ رَجُلًا يَتَقَلَّبُ فِي الْجَنَّةِ فِي شَجَرَةٍ قَطَعَهَا مِنْ ظَهْرِ الطَّرِيقِ كَانَتْ تُؤْذِي الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Subhanallah. I saw a man going about in the paradise. That was his final destination. From what he saw in his mi'raj, went to the seventh heaven. I saw a man who was one of the dwellers of paradise, of the garden, just because of a tree branch that he cut to remove it from the path of the Muslims, so it wouldn't annoy them. He's thinking of someone other than himself. And he stopped his business to go out of his way and make life easier for people he was never going to see, maybe. He wasn't going to have the satisfaction of watching them enjoy his efforts, perhaps. He did something knowing that others would benefit. In Usul al-Fiqh, we have something called al-wasf al-munasib, the appropriate description or descriptor. Adjective, qualifier, the appropriate qualifier. And when we're looking to join one ruling to another condition, so for example, grape wine is haram to drink, is unlawful to drink. Is it because it's red or purple? Is that the reason why it's unlawful? Is that a good reason? Is that an appropriate qualifier or descriptor? Maybe not. Is it because it's liquid? Maybe not so much. It has another factor, it's intoxicating. That seems that that might be closer to what the Sharia is interested in, keeping people's mental capacity on point. So then if we find another substance that has the same intoxicating effect, we might say that it has the same ruling as the first thing. So those other aspects, such as it being purple or red, it being liquid, it being something that's contained in cups or glasses, these other descriptions of the case, we're going to dismiss those as not relevant to the judgment. Here, the person has removed something harmful from the roadway that was going to perhaps annoy or harm the Muslims. Well, is it important that the passers-by be Muslim for him to be rewarded in this way? Maybe. Maybe there's an extra reward for having a sensitivity for brothers and sisters in faith, of course. However, in this particular situation, maybe it's not that important that the other people were Muslims. For example, when it comes to the treatment of animals, we have the hadith in which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, دَخَلَتْ إِمْرَأَةٌ النَّارَ فِي حِجْرَةٍ حَبَسَتْهَا. Now, مَا أَطْعَمَتْهَا وَمَا تَرَكَتْهَا تَأْخُذُ مِنْ I can't do it. A woman entered the fire because of a cat that she locked up. She didn't feed it, nor did she allow it to search for the rodents of the earth, right? Rodents and insects and things that a cat might eat, right? And I can't get the pronunciation right. So we look at this. A woman enters the fire because of a cat. You can take, is it important that it be a cat? Is this just for cats? Is it a very special love that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has for cats and no one else? You can abstract this out by moving from the species cat to the genus animal. You could even go to a higher, more general genus, right? Such as living thing. So a woman and then enters the fire. A woman, is it important that she be female, that the person be female? This is only against women, right? So a person now is going to be punished for their abuse. So she locked up the cat. Well, locking someone up, something up, and not allowing it, not feeding it, and not allowing it to find its own food, that is a type of abuse. So we abstract that out to the more general. A person will be punished for their abuse of a living thing, or their abuse of animals in general. SubhanAllah. Then I always saw another thing, another insight into that, a hadith, that when you have a manager in your company that does not give you a game plan and tell you what we need to be doing, right? Nor do they let you have the authority to figure out a way to get the job done or to deliver on the business at hand, right? Always saying, nope, right? Don't do anything until I tell you. And then they never tell you what it is that needs to be done, right? Well, maybe that manager needs to be disciplined, right? So a manager might get disciplined for not giving a game plan to his subordinates or empowering them to set up their own program of action. No. SubhanAllah. The next hadith, number 12. The Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام says, مَنْ تَوَضَّأَ فَأَحْسَنَ الْوُضُوءَ ثُمَّ أَتَى الْجُمْعَةَ فَاسْتَمَعَ وَأَنْصَطَ غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ الْجُمْعَةِ وَزِيَادَةُ ثَلَاثَةِ أَيَّامٍ وَمَنْ مَسَّ الْحَصَى فَقَدْ لَهَا. So whoever makes wudu and does a good job and goes to the Jumu'ah Friday prayer and listens quietly, silently to the khutbah, everything will be forgiven between one Friday and the next, plus the weekend, an additional 3 days. Right? That's a good deal. But then he said, pays attention, listen silently. Whoever plays with any pebbles or something like that in front of them has lost that reward. Has caused, you know, allowed themselves to be distracted. Mm-hmm. Hasn't listened silently to the Jumu'ah. Tell you, perhaps the same goes for the person who's watching out for who's not paying attention. Right? They're more consumed with what others are doing during Jumu'ah And are they paying attention properly or not? And it should be me that goes, right, and tells them to shush, right? Well, maybe they've, also, the brother showed that maybe people are messing with their phones, right? Khalas, the new hasa, faqad laha, right? With his cell phone during Jum'ah. Subhanallah. So we're not there to police other people, but at the same time, we need to make an effort to be conscientious of other people. You know, sometimes, oftentimes in the sister's area, sometimes in the brother's area, people get to having all types of conversations, and they've been looking forward to Friday because it's the only time I get out of the house. I'm going to see my friend, and I'm so excited, and we're there to chat. That's not fair to the sisters who are there to, you know, observe the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Distractions in the masjid in general. People come to the masjid to turn their hearts to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't want to be creating distractions or creating situations where people's hearts are consumed with me. People's hearts are consumed with the fact that I'm annoying them in the masjid. Okay, or I'm playing footsie with them in the line of prayer or these other types of things. That's haram, right? To distract someone while they're in the business of praying. Right? We don't want to do that. Allah forgive us. The next hadith. When the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا توضأ العبد المسلم أو المؤمن فغسل وجهه خرج من وجهه كل خطيئة نظر إليها بعينيه مع الماء. When a believer makes wudu and washes his face فغسل وجهه, all of the sins and mistakes that he may have looked at or she may have looked at with his two eyes fall away. And in another narration, or with the last drop of water. Subhanallah. And if he or she washes their hands, every sin that may have been done with the hands falls away, or with the last drop of water. And when they wash their feet, all of the sins that they may have walked toward with their two feet fall away with the last drop of water, until this person who's making wudu leaves the process of wudu naqiyan min al-dhunub, completely purified from these minor sins. Because of course the major sins require a specific tawbah, okay, the specific process of tawbah. But in walking to the masjid and sitting between prayer and prayer and making wudu and letting the drops of water fall, all of these minor sins that we rack up can fall away from the fadl and generosity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the reason why Imam Shafi'i, in his school of law, he put that it is makruh to dry yourself off after making wudu. You should drip dry. And of course the fuqaha say, unless you have a condition where it would bother you a great deal and sort of like consume your thought, like annoy you, right? If your limbs were wet, that would be problematic, or if it's winter time or something like that. But in a good condition, the middle of summer, drip dry, right? Because he said, we don't want people to be wiping away the ajr that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written for them, or that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made for them, as if they don't want what Allah has on offer. Radiallahu an Imam Shafi'i. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the 14th hadith, As-salawatu al-khamsu والجمعة إلى الجمعة ورمضان إلى رمضان مكفرات لما بينهن إذا اجتنبت الكبائر. Subhanallah. One of the five prayers to the next of the five prayers, Friday prayer to Friday prayer, Ramadan to Ramadan, each of these is an expiation, is an erasure of any of the sins that may have come in between them. So long as a person stays away from the major sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Allah give us tawfiq. How are we for time? Allah protect us. Allah give us these opportunities. There's a narration that's reported from the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, in which he says, "Inna li rabbikum fi ayami dahrikum lanafahat." Your Lord has in the days of your times gentle breezes. Ala fata'arradu laha. Won't you avail yourselves of them? SubhanAllah. And what are these breezes? Opportunities like this to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Opportunities like this to make up for some of our shortcomings with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Opportunities to be in a gathering where the mention of Allah and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is happening, where the remembrance of Allah is happening, where the learning of the deen of Allah is happening, or one of these kathratul turaq al khayr, these many ways of doing good deeds, is made available. Right? You see something that might cause a person to trip and fall in the pathway, and it crosses your mind, you know, I could remove that. SubhanAllah. That's a nafha from the nafahat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And maybe it's in that that we find an acceptance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah to give us a moment with Him. A moment of sincerity, a moment of effort, to give us one action that He accepts and that He rewards with His contentment. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us that one secret in our lives that brings us close to Him and that He forgives us for and makes us of those who will always be in His presence. SubhanAllah. And what we have left of our lives, we can seek out what that is. That's a good mission. To have in my mind, what is that thing? And I'm not going to stop at one thing. I'll try a number of them. And inshallah, one of them is going to contain that secret of Allah's contentment, Allah's acceptance of me. Right? Not me out trying to score points. Not me out trying to put, you know, round pegs into round holes and square pegs into square holes and tick boxes and go down checklists, but to have a moment of sincerity that is accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What a beautiful thing. Allah give us as our sustenance to have that. Allah bless us with something like that. Ya Rabbi. In the next hadith, number 15, the Messenger alayhi salatu wa salam says, أَلَا أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَىٰ مَا يَمْحُ اللَّهُ بِهِ الْخَطَايَا وَيَرْفَعُ بِهِ الدَّرَجَاتِ. Shall I not indicate to you what Allah will, what Allah will use to erase faults and to raise ranks and stations? And they said, indeed, Messenger of Allah, he said, إِسْبَاغُ الْوُضُوءِ عَلَى الْمَكَارِهِ. Making your wudu, right, all the way beyond the elbow, way behind the feet, when it's inconvenient to do so. Oftentimes we think about the winter time, right? Nobody wants to get up before sunrise and make wudu with cold water. Nobody wants to do that, except for somebody who's like just lost in love, right? Do anything for their beloved, right? Inshallah, we'll get to that maqam. But the fact that you would get up before sunrise when it's cold and the bed is warm and go and make wudu with that water is difficult. Maybe even it feels like it hurts a little bit when I do it. Maybe it feels a lot like it hurts when I do it. Because you can be in situations where you have to use cold, have cold water on your skin. SubhanAllah. No. And it's painful. And you do it for all types of reasons. You do it because you have to. You do it because this is how you're going to earn your money. You do it because you're afraid of the consequences if you don't. But would you do it out of love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? paycheck, not to avoid a beating, but do it out of love. What a beautiful thing. SubhanAllah. And we think about winter, but what about doing it at work? What about doing it at the office? What about doing that, in a public restroom where other people are going to see you putting your foot in the sink, right? Splashing water all over the place, and what's wrong with you? You're making a mess. You know, I'm really trying to do the right thing. I know it looks like I'm doing the wrong thing, but you just got to trust me. And you know, it can be, I feel a little bit embarrassing sometimes, right? SubhanAllah. That's the same thing as what he's talking about here. That what Allah will use to erase your faults and raise your rank. Maybe somebody will just go out after this and like look for a public situation. I don't know, I can make wudu in the muwadda, in the masjid. I can make wudu at home and then pray. But I'm going to go out to like a real fancy place that's very public and make wudu there, right? And do it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَكَثْرَةُ الْخُطَعِ إِلَى الْمَسَاجِدِ. And in addition to that, taking many steps to the masjid. You know, if you set out to go to the masjid and it's a long way away, maybe you don't have to, right? If it's not in walking distance from your house. But if you decide that you are going to go do that, and you do it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not for another reason, because you want to go to His house and put your forehead on the floor in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or you do it often, and there's your kathra. Subhanallah. What's it? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say to Ali ibn Abi Talib, when Hatim ibn Abi Balta'a sent news to give away the invasion of Mecca because he was afraid for his family members in Mecca, so he sent the letter with the woman to expose it, and she was caught by Ali ibn Abi Talib before the letter could make it, walhamdulillah, but Ali thought that he should be killed for his khiyana, for his betrayal, and of course it was a betrayal. He did it out of fear for his family. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, how do I know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not look to the people who fought at Badr when they didn't have to and said, I forgive everything you've ever done or are ever going to do? SubhanAllah. There are people who have gone through things in their lives and run to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who have seen how the earth has constricted around them to the point where their own souls have constricted around them, until they knew that there was nowhere to run from Allah except for to Allah. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عَجَبًا مِنْ أُنَاسٍ سَاقُوا إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ بِالسَّلَاسِلِ. Allah is impressed with a people who are driven into Jannah in chains. غَصْبًا عَنْهُمْ رَغْمَ أُنُوفِهِمْ. They weren't looking for Allah, but they found themselves face to face with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they knew the haqq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's not what they were looking for. This is the reality of people around us. And Allah knows who those people are. Allahumma ja'alna minhum. Allahumma arrifna bihim. Allah, make us among them. Allah, let us come to know people of this. People who know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not in theory, but despite themselves. What a beautiful thing. What a beautiful world. What an amazing universe. What an incredible reality that is this reality of Al-Haq subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we want to bring our theories and ideas into it. We just need to let it play out. And we need to be there to go along for the ride and not underestimate anyone. Hasha. That we find ourselves in a position where we're underestimating a wali of Allah, or a waliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. because these are the ones that Allah loves. Subhanallah. وَانْتِذَارُ الصَّلَاةِ بَعْدَ الصَّلَاةِ فَذَٰلِكُمُ الرِّبَاطِ. And waiting for the next prayer after having already prayed one of the prayers. That is ribat. And what is ribat in murabata? Murabata is when you sit out on the frontiers of the Muslim lands to guard the boundaries of the Muslim population, to keep them protected from the enemies, and you're waiting for an enemy to come. This can be literal, right? This can be literal. Those people who are at guard posts in the mountain passes, watching out for an enemy to come and violate the Muslim precincts. But here, that same rank, that same favor, that same blessing is given to people who are looking out and watching out for opportunities to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who are looking out and watching out to strengthen their hearts and be near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are rewards that Allah has to give. We aren't the ones who decide what Allah can give someone and what Allah can't give someone. It's for us to keep our ears open and our mouths more closed, and I keep my mouth closed, right? And just listen and learn. Because the universe is Allah's universe. The reality is Allah's reality. And we think other people have a say in it. But we're not listening. Barakallahu feekum. Wa ahsanallahu ilaykum. We'll read our Wednesday dua, inshallah. Ya Rabbi. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Our praise is due to Allah, Lord of the worlds. قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ بَصَائِرُ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ فَمَنْ أَبْصَرَ فَلِنَفْسِهِ وَمَنْ عَمِيَ فَعَلَيْهَا. There have come to you insights from your Lord. So whosoever gains insight, it is to his benefit. And whosoever is blind, it is to his detriment. اللهم صلي على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمَ. اللَّهُمَّ bestow your blessings upon our Master Muhammad and upon his family and companions and give them peace. يَا مُقَلِّبَ الْقُلُوبِ وَالْأَبْصَارِ ثَبِّتْ قُلُوبَنَا عَلَىٰ دِينِكَ. Overturner of hearts and eyes, make our hearts firm on your deen. يَا مُصَرِّفَ الْقُلُوبِ صَرِّفْ قُلُوبَنَا عَلَىٰ طَاعَتِكَ. Director of hearts, direct our hearts to your obedience. اللَّهُمَّ أَلْهِمْنِي رُشْدِي وَأَعِذْنِي مِنْ شَرِّ نَفْسِي. اللَّهُمَّ inspire in me my best direction and protect me from the bad within me. Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min yawmi as-su'i wa min laylati as-su'i wa min sa'ati as-su'i wa min sahibi as-su' wa min jari as-su'i fi dar al-muqama. Allahumma, I seek refuge in you from a bad day, from a bad night, from a bad moment, from a bad friend, and from a bad neighbor in the eternal home. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Allah, bless your families and bless your children and bless our family and bless our children. Ayyadakum Allah wa ahsanallahu ilaykum. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.